dear students, my friends, and to all the viewers. I'm Dr. Santosh Patel, professor in general and minimal access surgery. Today I'll be addressing a class on wound healing. This is the most basic subject or the topic that has to be addressed in general surgery. As an MBBS student, it's very, very important to understand the basics of wound healing and what are the abnormal healing, that is, what are the different types of healing that takes place in the wound and what are the factors that affects the wound healing. It has been asked plenty of times in the theory questions for factors affecting the wound healing. I'll be also addressing the different types of wounds, that is, acute wound and the chronic wounds. Wound healing, there is a few normal process that wound heals. One should know the normal process of wound healing. There are three phases of wound healing. The first phase being the hemostasis and inflammation. Whenever there is an injury to a body, to prevent further injury, the body goes into a state of, starts a process of hemostasis, that is by initial vasoconstriction followed by aggregation of the platelets, which leads to hemostasis to prevent further bleed and to clear the debris because of the dead tissue, that is because of bacteria or it can be a foreign body or the dead host tissue. To remove the debris, there will be inflammatory infiltrate. These inflammatory infiltrate will be in the form of neutrophils and the macrophages. The second phase is, once the debris has been cleared and the further injury to the tissue is halted, then the next process of wound healing starts, that is mainly by the proliferation. The proliferation is mainly by the deposition of the collagen and matrix metalloproteinase. The last phase is nothing but maturation. So once the wound process of healing starts taking place, to prevent abnormal healing, the wound starts remodeling itself and starts maturing. So I'll be just discussing in detail about the hemostasis and inflammation, because these are the most basic phases. Whenever there is an injury, the vasoconstriction and thrombus formation forms to limit the further blood loss. This thrombus is mainly because of the platelets that gets adhered to the damaged endothelium. Platelets release certain cytokines. The cytokines can be in the form of a platelet derived growth factor, platelet factor 4, and transforming growth factor beta. All these cytokines are released mainly from the alpha granules of the platelets. The function of these cytokines is mainly to attract the inflammatory mediators, inflammatory cells. These cells are nothing but neutrophils and macrophages. For the first 72 hours, that is the acute phase of wound, usually the neutrophils come into the picture and start clearing all the debris. And by the end of 72 hours, the macrophages also comes into the picture to clear the debris. So platelets and local injured tissue release vasoactive amines, mainly to help in bringing the macrophages. So this is a picture which shows, there is a first picture where the disruption of the blood vessels followed by platelets aggregation, and then there will be a migration of the inflammatory infiltrates and a fibrin deposition. The main structural support means, once the debris has been cleared, a structural support or the base is formed mainly by the fibrin, which is produced by the fibrinogen, over which the next phase, that is a phase of proliferation, starts taking place. The proliferation is mainly by the fibroblasts. The fibroblasts are mainly responsible for the deposition of calcium and the ground substance in the form of glycosaminoglycans and glycans and proteoglycans. The collagen, that is importantly responsible for forming the scaffolding or the proliferation of granulation tissue over the injured area, is mainly by the collagen 1 and collagen 3. Then once the collagen has been deposited from the endothelial, the endothelial damaged endothelial tissue, the blood vessels starts new blood vessels, that is new angiogenesis starts taking place and re-epithelialization also starts taking place. So this collagen intermingled with new angiogenesis, it is what we term it as granulation tissue. So this granulation tissue mainly consists of a type 3 collagen. This is mainly because of the multiple choice question they ask, what is the type of collagen? It is type 1 and type 3. The type 3 has the highest tensile strength, that is the, I have mentioned, type 3 collagen. This is a picture of the proliferation phase, where there is lymphocyte and neutrophils mainly clearing the debris and a clot is formed, that is to prevent further any blood loss, and also the fibrin has been deposited. The last phase is how the collagen matures and how the collagen contraction takes place and prevents the abnormal scar formation. That is what we term it as reorganization of the synthesized collagen. The collagen which has deposited, there is a process called as collagenolysis and collagenosynthesis. The net product is always the excessive collagen production that forms, and a remodeling takes place. This remodeling is mainly by the breakdown of the matrix metalloproteinase. At the end product is nothing but a cellular collagen rich scar. Then later on, once this collagen rich scar is formed, then the fibril formation and cross linking starts taking place in this collagen. By this, it makes the collagen, this fibril formation and cross linking makes the collagen strong and decreases its solubility. And the additional advantage is it increases the resistance to enzymatic degradation, means the scar becomes stable. This is a picture which shows the scab formation, that is the last stage, mainly by the fibroblast induced collagen deposition. So once we know the process of wound healing, we should know there are certain factors that prevent the wound healing, or what we can say, sometimes the process of wound healing is delayed. So we should know these factors. What are the factors? These factors can be depending upon the site of the wound and depending upon the structures that are involved. There are plenty of factors, the local factors, the systemic factors. I'll be pointing out few factors because it has been asked plenty of times in the form of major question, or it can be in the form of a short notes. If the site of the wound, for example, if the site of the wound is on the face, the wound healing is usually faster because of the excellent vascularity and there is less chance of wound infection. If the same site of the wound is, if the wound is usually on the joint aspect, or where there is maximum mobility taking place in the body, usually the process of wound healing is delayed because the collagen which needs to be stabilized is not proper. So destabilization of the collagen takes place and the process of wound healing is always delayed. Example, what we see is in a orthopedic fractures, where the callus formation, though it takes place, the large phase of remodeling of the callus is delayed mainly because of the immobilization. So patient usually go into malunion or non-union. What are the different structures that are involved that prevent wound healing? If the wound is usually on the skin and subcutaneous tissue, definitely the wound healing process will be good. If the structures are nerve tissue involvement, or the more vascularity is severe in association with the wound, definitely the process of wound healing is delayed. And the other factors that are responsible for poor wound healing or delayed wound healing are the mechanism. If the wound is clean wound, that is in the form of a surgical incision, the process of wound healing is excellent because it follows all the stages of wound healing, in contrast to the crush injury or crush avulsion injury, where the damage is extensive and the process of wound healing takes large place because the debris clearing, the inflammatory process itself is prolonged in such cases. Sometimes the scar may be ugly looking scar because the healing may not be of primary intention, which I'll be talking again in next slides. And if the wound is contaminated, definitely if a patient is met with a road traffic accident and the wound has been, there is a crush injury and associated patient has lot of impaction of a bacteria or a foreign body during road traffic accident, when the patient comes to emergency, cleaning this area and leaving the wound open for some time in the form of healing of secondary or tertiary intention may be the criteria of treating such patient. In such cases, the wound is not in a healing in a normal process. Loss of tissue, again, loss of tissue itself prevents wound healing of normal process. There are certain other factors, that is the local factors and systemic factors, which we are supposed to know. Here one point I need to add, age is one factor where it has to be considered. Old age patient usually have impaired wound healing. The main reason is mainly because of decreased non-collagenous protein. This is nothing but a protein which is classically, they have done a lot of studies in a young patient and the old patient. In the young patient, they have found out increased amount of total alpha amino nitrogen. This is nothing but a total protein which is responsible for formation healthy collagen, and which again promotes the wound healing faster in a younger patient. It has to be taken into consideration. The local factors are nothing but the vascular insufficiency, previous irradiation and pressure. Vascular insufficiency is very, very important thing, because when we'll be dealing with the chronic wounds, the main factor for poor wound healing in chronic wounds is mainly because of the vascular insufficiency. A vascular insufficiency may be in the form of atherosclerotic blockage of the vessel, or it could be a venous congestion or chronic venous insufficiency in varicose veins. The main reason how the vascular insufficiency prevents is mainly because of decreased fibroplasia and decreased collagen synthesis. Means it these hamper the fibroblast induced collagen deposition in the tissues. The systemic factors that need to be addressed are malnutrition and vitamin and mineral deficiency. It has been proved like vitamin C, vitamin A and zinc are strongly responsible for maturation of the scar and healthy collagen deposition. Whenever there is a deficiency of these three proteins and minerals, that is zinc deficiency, patient have delayed wound healing. In pediatric, it has been proved any patient with the dermatitis or dermatological infection, the zinc has proven to be healing better in pediatric patients. This is like diabetes mellitus. Diabetes mellitus itself is a condition where there is abnormal glucose which promotes the bacterial overgrowth in the high glucose media. Diabetes also decreases the process of inflammation. That is, the first stage of inflammation is totally delayed by the diabetes, and also the neoangiogenesis which takes place from the endothelium is again hampered by the diabetes, and diabetes itself causes hypoperfusion to the tissues, again delaying the wound healing. Medication like steroids have been proved to delay the wound healing if given usually within first 3 days of inflammation. If whenever there is a surgery or there is an acute injury, it is better to delay the steroids for first 3 days. After 3 days, it has shown there is no much effect on the wound healing from the steroids. Steroids, especially the long-acting steroids. These steroids decrease collagen synthesis and also it dampens or hampers the wound strength. It is mainly by, again, these, just like diabetes, these act at the inflammatory phase of wound healing and decreases the neoangiogenesis. And they have also shown to decrease the activity of the macrophages and preventing their migration towards the site of inflammation in the acute phase of wound, that is inflammatory phase, and also decreases the epithelialization. Immunodeficiencies, definitely immunodeficiency, maybe because of the chemotherapy or acquired immunodeficiency aids, where the cellular action is totally hampered. Again, patients have poor wound healing. Smoking again causes poor wound healing. Then, depending upon the type of the wound, if it is a tidy wound are nothing but planned wound, which usually happens in a clear cut wounds, or it can be a planned surgical wounds where the incisions are very precise and clear cut. It's a tidy wound type, comes under tidy wound. It's a clean one. Healthy tissues are there because there is no devitalized tissue and seldom tissue loss is seen. In contrast, untidy wounds where there is crushed or avulsed, lot of contamination usually happens, where patient requires thorough cleaning or 2 or 3 settings may be required to clean the contaminated area. And if there is a devitalized tissue, patient needs to undergo 2 or 3 again procedures, multiple procedures, to access the devitalized tissue so the new granulation tissue start taking place. And often, if associated with tissue loss, again patient will have poor wound healing. So there are different process of wound healing taking place in different tissues that we need to understand. In bone, all the phases of wound healing are same, except in the phase of proliferation. Usually the periosteal and endosteal proliferation leads to callus formation instead of granulation tissue. And the last phase of remodeling, the cortical structure and medullary cavities are restored. In the nerve, it is mainly because of the Wallerian degeneration, that is distal to the wound, the process of healing starts initiation, and the regenerating nerve fibers are attracted to their receptors by neuroptism, the process of growth of the nerve fibers. And the profuse growth of nerve fibers that starts at the proximal end is the thing what it is seen. If there is abnormal or uncontrolled proliferation of these new nerve fibers at the proximal end, there are high chances of neuroma formation. If there is a tendon, the tendon repair usually starts mainly because of the nutrition and the new vessel formation. And also this nutrition to the tendon is received by two mechanisms. One is the intrinsic mechanism, where there is a vesicular flow and the synovial diffusion taking place in the intrinsic part, intrinsic to the tendon, and extrinsic to the tendon is mainly from the fibrin's adhesion that takes place between the tendon and the tendon sheath. This process is very very slow process. That is why the tendon, because that is the reason the tendon are the last very slow healing structure compared to other structures. The tensile strength usually takes first to 3 to 6 weeks. Then classification, wound healing and closure of the healing. There are different type of wounds that needs different closure. The healing may be in the form of a primary intention, where usually surgical incisions, what we call it, where there are precise cuts are there, and healing takes by normal process. All three phases of wound healing are seen. Secondary intention, this is a primary intention picture which is showing proper epithelialization, connective tissue repair taking place as per the process of all the wound healing. So it forms a healthy or minimal scar or healthy looking clean clear cut scars. Healing by secondary intention is mainly where the wound is left open, mainly because of the lot of contamination taking place, and this tissue heals by granulation, contraction and epithelialization. If you see the picture, it's very very clear. The process of wound healing is not normal compared to that of a primary intention, where lot of granulation tissue needs to grow between the tissue, and the process of contraction and epithelialization are very much delayed. If you see, compared to the primary, the secondary wound healing, the scar are very bad looking scar. The tertiary intention is mainly where there is delayed primary intention, means the wound is left open to heal, or then the edges are approximated later when the healing conditions are favorable. Usually happens whenever there is a lot of infection, debridement, everything takes place, then wound is left to heal, then a suturing is done later on to approximate the edges. Specific wounds, the acute wounds can be in the form of bites. The bites can be human bites or animal bites that needs to be addressed. And puncture wounds can be a sharp needle prick injuries, or any sharp injuries with a knife stab injuries also are puncture wounds. Hematoma formation are which presents as acute. Means whenever there is a trauma and muscular injury usually takes place, usually in the thigh muscles or abdominal rectus muscle hematoma. These hematomas needs to be presents as acute symptoms and need to be addressed. Degloving injury are nothing but where the total skin loss is there. Means usually this type of injury requires immediate treatment, where patient has to be given thorough debridement and cleaning, and all the devitalized tissue needs to be excised. In such cases, degloving injury, usually patient will require a process where skin grafting has to be done. Compartment syndrome are again a specific type of wound where there is acute presentation. Usually a cellulitis left untreated will go into collection of fluid into the compartmental spaces and starts causing severe pain. The treatment for this type of compartment syndrome is mainly by the release incision what we give in the facial planes. What we call as fasciotomies are done usually to release the pressure from these compartments. And last are high pressure injection injuries. These are type of injuries usually seen in the painters, where usually the under high pressure the paint usually spreads along the facial planes. This type of injury needs immediate attention, where it cannot be delayed, because the compartment pressure is such high the tissue goes into rapid destruction. Patient requests thorough cleaning because it's a foreign body in the form of paints which is usually spreading into the facial planes, that needs to be cleaned and cleared. There are specific management for the wound, that is first cleaning is very very important for any patient. If there is bites, as discussed, that patient bite area needs to be cleaned, exposed, and exploration and diagnosis has to be assessed, where exactly is the wound. For example, puncture wounds. If there is a puncture wound in the form of a stab injury, the the stab wound may be only in the muscular pain, but patient should be thoroughly evaluated to rule out any injury to the visceral structure in the abdominal cavity. A thorough diagnosis has to be done. Patient requests further evaluation in the form of an X-ray abdomen to rule out hollow viscous perforation, or it can be a ultrasound of the abdomen to rule out any hemoperitoneum. Debridement. Any degloving injury, as I already discussed, patient may require thorough debridement. If it is a clear cut wound, patient will just require cleaning and suturing. If the tissue is devitalized, the tissue has to be debrided till a fresh bleeding start taking place. That indicates again wound it's a healthy tissue. Repair of the structures has to be done. This depending upon the type of wound. If it is a clear cut wound, primary suturing can be done. If it is a unhealthy or a devitalized tissue is there, then patient has to be decided on secondary or tertiary type of healing. Replacement of tissue loss, as I discussed already, if there is a degloving injury, lot of skin loss is there, patient has to be immediately subjected for a skin grafting. Skin cover is required, that is skin grafting is the technique. Always a suturing has to be done without tension. This again prevents pressure necrosis and tissue necrosis that is going to happen under tension, that has to be avoided. Then there are different chronic wounds. Chronic wounds are nothing but leg ulcers or long time ulcer which do not heal by regular treatment. They require special attention. And pressure sore. Pressure sores are the one usually dependent on the decubitus, also called as decubitus ulcer, commonly seen on the sacral area, the heel area are the common site where the pressure sores are seen. Next class, I'll be dealing with examination of an ulcer in detail. That will be again management of chronic wounds will be covered in that topic. Thank you very much.